Everybody, Private Kirk Womack, 6th Indiana Volunteer Infantry Company B, reporting for duty. With the cold weather coming on here in Indiana, I got to thinking about all different things that reenactors need and use in the cold weather, and the original men of the Union Army used in the cold weather. And I got to thinking about something that would be appropriate for this time of year that hasn't been talked too much about in the reenacting community, and I decided on this. There's a little article everybody uses. Every reenactor, a lot of other people, it's kind of taken for granted. And that article is, of course, a match. Matches were used in the Civil War. They were issued to the men in some quantities. Whether the men bought them themselves for settlers or they were issued to them, I'm not sure of the exact numbers. But they were used. They were carried by the men. And they were considered indispensable. So, I'm going to talk to you about the forms of matches that were available in the 1860s. I'll talk to you the methods of carrying them to where you wouldn't burn a hole in your pocket. And we're just going to try to inform you all we can. See if we can teach you something. Thank you very much, folks. Hope you enjoy it.
All right. The first thing we're going to talk about is match safes. This is basically what the matches were carried in. Back in the early days of friction matches, the chemical formula used to make them was a little bit volatile, if you will. They had a tendency to ignite when you didn't want them to, and so they started making what they called match safes, and they were just to hold the matches in. They were fire retardant, fireproof containers to put the matches in while you're carrying them in your pocket, so you didn't burn your clothes up and ruin your entire day. So I have an overabundance here of rubber match safes. These three here, the two black ones and the brown colored one, are all made of hard rubber. Now, hard rubber was a very popular material during the Civil War era. The process for it was patented by Charles Goodyear's brother, Nelson Goodyear, in 1851, and became very popular. It was used for just about everything from combs to buttons to match safes to just about anything you could imagine, really, that modernly is made of plastic. But anyway, hard rubber had a added benefit of being fairly fireproof, so it was a practical way to make match safes, practical material to make match safes cheaply, because you could just take a sheet of hard rubber, put it in the mold, press it into the mold, and it would after it cured, it would be, after it was vulcanized in the mold, it would be hard and immovable, and it would hold its shape. And hard rubber is actually a fairly durable material, but anyway, we have three hard rubber safes, and we have one nickel-plated brass, at least it used to be nickel-plated. The only one of these that I can definitely date to the Civil War era is this one right here. The lighting isn't the best, I don't know if you can see, but this one is actually stamped Goodyear's patent, if you can see that. And Goodyear's patent for hard rubber was Nelson Goodyear's patent. It was in effect from 1851. I can't remember the month or the day. From 1851 until 1872, they were granted a patent extension. The family was in 1865. And then, as you can see on this side, it is stamped NR Company. And that stands for the Novelty Rubber Company. And they were in business from 1855... to about 1883, I believe. But anyway, the fact that it's stamped Goodyear's patent tells me that this was made between the years of 1855 and 1872. And Francis Lord has this listed in his Civil War Collector's Encyclopedia, this very safe right here. So that's kind of a neat little piece. I like that real well. I found that on eBay a while back. And this one is also listed in Francis Lord's Collector's Encyclopedia. I actually have my doubts about whether or not this is in fact from the Civil War era. There's a very similar one that is listed in the 1909 Sears Roebuck catalog. I almost halfway suspect these were made for the Spanish-American War, but I'm not certain. A lot of people have said these are Civil War. A lot of these have been dug on Civil War battle sites, battlefields. It's a spring-loaded, just a simple spring-loaded safe with a hinge, and the striker's on the bottom, just like with the hard rubber safe, the rough striking surfaces on the bottom there. Anyway, and obviously these were all for strike anywhere matches. They used to be just called friction matches. That's how they all were. But nowadays, if you were to be buying matches to put in these, you'd be looking for strike anywhere matches, which are getting a little hard to find. I'll get into that in a little bit. And these two, this one, I believe, is the earlier of these two. This one's actually inscribed GB Bowling. I've done a little bit of research. I have not found this gentleman listed as having served in the Civil War, so I'm kind of curious as to whether this could have been carried, but I know that they did have these. These had flip open ends like this. They opened like a pocket knife. This back piece of rubber was acting as a spring, and it would hold the two end pieces closed. You could open either end. But anyway, that's the earlier of these two. They're both are the same type. This one has a little bit more spring left in it, and as you can see, it's embossed with a diamond pattern. It was molded into the rubber at the time of vulcanization, has the striker on this side. Anyway, this one I actually suspect was made about 1880, just because of the fanciness of it. But I could be wrong. It could be Civil War. But the fact that these two are not marked with Charles Goodyear or Nelson Goodyear's 1851 patent information leads me to believe they might be post-Civil War, or they could have been produced illegally. But anyway, but any one of these, if you wanted to use these for your impression in the Civil War, you could. This one would obviously be ideal, this one or this one, since you have documentation about them. This one, the horse soldier in Gettysburg, has sold a few of these for about $95 a piece, if I remember right. I bought this one on eBay about a year ago. I believe I paid $50 for it. Most of them you see are like this. They were originally nickel-plated, and you see a few shiny spots here and there, but mostly just worn through to the brass. But I wouldn't spend more than $75 on one of these, to be honest with you. If it was me, I'd actually rather have a rubber safe, because especially one like this, nice thing about this is the slip cap is actually fairly firm. This one actually has original matches in it. I bought an original strip of matches to put in it. But anyway, nice thing about these, they're a little bit waterproof, so they will keep your matches dry better than any of these. But anyway, this is another thing. If you want to get into a post-war veteran impression like the GAR, this is a good thing to have here. These are kind of neat. You can get these on eBay for about $15, $20. It is, I don't know if the autofocus will work. There it is, Knapsack Matches. As you can see, it is made, it's stamped steel with gold lacquer coating, United Machine Supply Company, and it is in the form of an old Union knapsack, and it has a little flip open, has a little striker on the bottom here. These were actually made to be dispensed out of an early form of vending machine, a mechanical vending machine. You look up knapsack matches on the internet, and you'll probably be able to find some pictures of the vending machines, but as I understand it, these are listed in Francis Lord's encyclopedia. He made a mistake. He listed these, I believe, as Civil War era. You got to remember something about the Civil War Collector's Encyclopedia. Mr. Lord, or Dr. Lord, I believe, wrote his encyclopedia back in the days before the internet, before all of the resources we have nowadays. So he wasn't able to just go on to Google or what have you and look up knapsack matches and find all of the information on them that he could. He had to go back to patent information and the early advertising. So he saw this, and he said, well, that looks kind of like a Civil War knapsack. I think that's probably Civil War. And he probably, he might have very well found one on a Civil War battlefield. As I say, I believe these were popular with, like, the GAR veterans groups, you know, and Spanish-American War veterans, all of those. This would just be kind of like a little novelty thing. I think the Spanish-American War is what caused them to start making those if they figured they would be popular. But they started making those about 1905, I believe. And they went till the late teens or something like that. I'm not certain of the exact dates. But anyway, If you're doing a GAR impression, that'd be kind of neat to pull out of your pocket, and they're not that expensive. So if you can find one on eBay, which you usually can, that's kind of a neat little added touch to make it a little more interesting. Anyway, now we're going to get into what kind of matches were available during the war. Well, as I said before, the matches during the Civil War were what you would call friction matches. The very early matches were called chemical matches, in that they would mix, and this was in the 1820s, they would mix two chemicals together and it would cause a chemical reaction that would cause a flame. Friction matches are the same general idea, only you aren't mixing the chemicals. You know, early ones, I believe, were sulfuric acid and another chemical, phosphorus, I believe. But anyway, the friction matches were all the chemicals were in the head, and then when you struck it, the friction would mix two chemicals together, and it would produce the flame. One of the so all of the matches basically use the same chemical composition in the heads, but there were different forms of matches. Now, the one that you usually see and people think of as being related to the Civil War are the card matches, or the strip matches. And all they are, they're just a wooden sheet. Of course, they'd be long in the factory. Then they would take a lathe and cut little notches out, and then they would take it and dip the whole board in the solution, the chemical solution for the fire-producing chemicals, and then they would take, I don't know exactly how they did it, they must have had a bunch of very sharp blades, and it would come down, and it would split all of this wood to about right there. And all this is solid, so all you would have to do is that as you wanted to use them, you just break one off of the strip and strike it. Now, obviously, to use them in any of these match safes, you would have to either break them up. What I did was, with this, I got this strip fairly cheap, so I just broke it in half. And I actually, believe it or not, and all you collectors out there, don't get mad at me, there are plenty of these around, I actually tried one of these matches. I tested it, and it did work. It was hard to light. I struck it right on the bottom of this, the Goodyear Patent match safe. And after two or three strikes, good hard ones, it did light. It was kind of feeble, because obviously some of the chemicals, I'm sure, have degraded over the years. But it did light. It had a very strange smell to it. It almost smelled like burning paint. I don't know what that is about. But anyway, they did light and they did work. So that's very interesting to me. So these things, and that's another thing. Be careful if you have these old matches in your collection. If you have them in a display case, be careful about direct sunlight, because if you have some weird reflections in there, it can act as a magnifying glass, and you don't want your collection to go up in smoke because of some still potent matches. But no, these old matches will still work, so be careful with how you handle them. But anyway, this is one way, and this is the most often thought of, and this is the one that is most considered a Civil War style match. They did have modern style matches like this, you know, your normal, the ones you think about that are loose like this. These are the ones I have. These are Strike Anywhere matches. And of course, this video is being made in early 2020, and Strike Anywhere matches, especially good ones, are getting very hard to find. The only ones available in the U.S. for the most part are diamond green light Strike Anywhere matches. That I've found that they are not very sensitive. They don't strike too terribly well. You will wear out your striker on your match safe pretty quick if you use them all the time, and they do degrade pretty quick, as in if they will absorb moisture from the air and they will go bad after a fairly short time. So there are two brands of match Strike Anywhere matches still being made that I consider excellent quality. There's one, it's called Cartwright's. They are made by a company in the United States, and they are mostly sold out in the Oregon, Washington, out in the northeast area of the United States, in a certain chain of grocery stores out there. I actually ordered, like the idiot I am, I ordered three boxes of them off of eBay. They are ridiculously expensive. They are about, I think I paid about $20 for three boxes of the large wooden kitchen matches. They are excellent, though. They are very good quality. They strike very easily. You can strike them on your thumbnail, just like the old ones. So that's impressive to me. The other brand is actually made by the same company that makes the Cartwrights, but they are sold exclusively in Canada, and they are called Redbird Strike Anywhere Matches. Those are equal to the quality of the Cartwrights. And the best part is, if you happen to live close to the Canada-U.S. border, or you ever take any trips to Canada on a regular basis, you can, in fact, buy those. I believe they're about the equivalent of $5 American for a pack of three of them. So, or if you have, what I did was, I have some friends that live up there, and they were kind enough to buy me two packages of three boxes while they were coming down to visit me for a short time. So that was a big help. So I have enough of them to last me a little while anyway. But no, those are the only two very good quality Strike Anywhere match brands that I know of that are still being produced. There used to be many others. There was Pinley and several others, but they've all gone out of business simply because of the hazardous shipping regulations. Strike Anywhere matches can ignite if you drop the box hard, or it bumps or shakes real fast because they're friction igniting. So they do come under the hazardous materials code of the U.S. Postal Service, so that makes it more expensive to ship them. So it pretty well drove a lot of these companies out of business. So I don't really suspect that they are going to be made for too many more years, which is sad. There are ways you can use these things. You can keep a striker strip. You can, you know, cut the side of the matchbox off and keep a striker strip in there with the matches if you want to, so you can take the strip out and strike it on that. But I'd much rather have an more authentic appearance. But anyway, sorry, I got off track. They did have these loose stick matches. Whenever they excavated the steamboat Arabia, which sunk in 1856, they uncovered a pretty fair number of wooden tubes of those stick matches. So they did have them before the Civil War and during. And they also had the only other example of matches of the Civil War that I've seen, or they were called block matches. And think about it like this, only a wooden block about an inch by an inch. And instead of splitting it like this, they split it this way, and then they turn around and split it this way. So you have a block, a solid block of wood, about that tall, about as tall as this is, with match heads on the top, and then saw cuts. So there's individual matches part of this bottom block, so you can break the matches off the base. But that was far less, that was not at all practical for carrying in a pocket unless you broke them all off the block. So this is what most people think of when they think of Civil War matches. And a lot of people, you know, you can use these just fine. So I wouldn't mess with it. What I did, just as an experiment, see if I can get it. There we go. I took some of these stick matches and very laboriously glued them together. I had to grind each side of the head flat on a grindstone or sandpaper, whatever, to where they'd glue together smoothly. It's not worth the trouble. Just take my word for that. It really isn't. It might look neat, but it's not worth the trouble. So, yeah, you just use your loose matches. It works just fine. But anyway, another thing, if you don't want to buy any of these match safes, you know, I think I spent $12 or something like that for this one on eBay. I spent right at $40 for this one, $40 for that one, about $50 for that one. I paid about $10 for that one. If you don't want to spend that kind of money, I mentioned the Steamboat Arabia and them shipping matches in wooden tubes. This, you can just find like a wooden tube like this. They use these of all shapes and sizes back in the early 1900s, even into the 50s almost, for packaging and shipping various things. This one actually has a sewing machine shuttle in it. It's an old boy sewing machine shuttle tube. You could take one of these. The original match shipping tubes were a little bit bigger around, but you can take these. This will hold maybe, I don't know, 10, 11 matches in there. What you could do, you could take your pocket knife or what have you and cut that lip off of there, take some sandpaper and sand this advertising off the side. And you could have a wooden tube match safe, which wouldn't be it would not be unauthentic, Wouldn't be the fanciest thing in the world, but it would work. Or, this is another idea, you could take any kind of little tin with a hinged lid like this. It doesn't have to be Altoids, but anything like this, you can either put it in the fire and burn the paint off of it, the finish, you know, with all the advertising lettering off. If that doesn't work, then you could sand it off. Or I even believe that they sell little tin boxes like this without any advertising on them already. So anyway, there were recorded examples of men carrying little tin boxes of matches like this. So something like this is not at all inaccurate, if as long as it doesn't say Altoids on it. That's that would be a FARB alert right there. But anyway, so there's just some ideas. And just as long as you have something like this, I mean, I'm not saying every soldier had a match safe, but I'm sure a lot of them did, because it just, especially the ones that smoked. But matches were pretty well a universally used thing back then, so I'd say it's a good addition to your impression if you can get a nice one like this. Brass is kind of nice because it's durable, but even a hard rubber one isn't bad. So anyway, but no, any one of these is good if you can find something else that you can find some provenance on and back it up historically with research. That's fine too. But no, you just, like I said in our last video, you do the best you can with what you got. If you don't have the money for an original, do the best you can to make you one that'll work. But just try to portray history as closely as you can, and do the best you can with what you got. That's all you can do, and enjoy it. Anyway, folks, I thank you very much for joining us, and thank you very much for listening and putting up with my annoying annoying voice for almost half hour. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed the video. I hope it taught you something. If you enjoyed it and you want to hear about more, just hit the subscribe button. And I'm going to try to start putting more videos on a more regular basis in the future. I'm going to keep on thinking up things that I haven't seen addressed anywhere else. And hope I can teach you something that you needed to know or wanted to know, something that you haven't heard before. Anyway, folks, I thank you so very much. This is Corporal now. That's another thing. Since the introduction was filmed, I have been promoted to Corporal, so just throw that out there. This is Corporal Kirk Womack of the 6th Indiana Volunteer Infantry Company B, saying thank you for watching. You all have a wonderful day, and talk to you again soon.